What's up, everybody? CJ Harris here with another episode of the Motostop Show, coming at you with episode 22. That's right, it's been 22 amazing shows. Well, some maybe not so amazing, but we're getting there. Back in studio with me, I'm super excited, super stoked, the man, the myth, the legend, the one and the only, Mr. Damien Plotts himself. Damien, how
What's
you
up,
been,
guys?
Dude?
So glad to be here again. Yeah, love coming to the Motostop Show. Awesome time.
It's been what? Probably 10 episodes since you've been in here, it seems like.
It might be, yeah, I'm not sure.
It's been way
up
too
here with
long.
Addison that one day. We made him do burpees on the air.
I remember, that was good stuff right there. So as we're on live and on our YouTube channel and podcast, you can check us at TuneIn, iTunes, Stitcher Radio, themotostopshow.com on Big Deal Productions. Pretty much, if you want to find us, we're not hard to find. We also got a brand new page we just launched. It's going to be The Motostop Show on Facebook. So eventually in the future, we'll start going live on that Facebook page right there for you guys. As well, we're on the Big Deal Production Instagram. So pretty much check us out. It's been good. And I got to first thank you, and we're going to talk a little bit later, but for coming on with the Plotts MX training tip of the week. It's been pretty good. Got a lot of great feedback about it.
Awesome.
The people out there are stoked. And I see some of your students actually jumping on right there as we see the list come on. We got Stephen Padano, our resident aircraft pilot.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So we got FMG, represent Andrew in the house. John Mortenberg, everybody's starting to jump on, so it looks like we're going to have a great show tonight. We got a lot of stuff to cover. I mean, Salt Lake City, Utah has came and gone, and I don't think we could have asked for a better race coming down to the wire.
The anticipation.
Oh, my God.
Phenomenal. Yeah. And believe me, when UFC was on, I was like, you kidding me? Throwing stuff at the TV.
We're going to talk about that. We're going to definitely talk about that. We're also going to talk about the 450 race. You know, the 250, 450 cover both of them. We're going to break down the track a little bit. I want to get your thoughts on the track. We're going to have a phone interview today. Finally got Justin Starling on board, lined up. We're going to talk to him at 7:15. We're also going to have a special guest coming on, another phone interview around 7:45. Mm-hmm. So we got a busy show and a short time to do it. I know I know the production crew said we got an hour, but I told them maybe we'll get it done in about 4 or 5 hours. So if you're on Facebook Live, grab yourself a coffee and a soda and hang on, because we're going for a ride tonight.
Right on.
Dude, let's kick it off and let's talk about the 250 Salt Lake City Supercross. I guess we first got to mention the new champion.
New champion.
West Coast champ, Justin Hill himself.
How many years has he been working for that?
Oh, a lot.
I think it's been at least six.
I would say you're probably six or seven.
I don't know. I should have looked that up before we came.
Yeah, six or seven.
You don't have that data?
Seven.
Okay. This guy's on it.
Seven. So, you know, the cool thing about that, and most people don't know, is that, and we see all you guys coming on right there, Gardner, my wife and my mother and Moto right there. So, the cool thing about our West Coast champion, Justin Hill, out there riding for Mitch Payton and the Pro Circuit Kawasaki team, is he rode for them before.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, whether he quit or got fired, they separated ways. And most of the time when that happens in our sport and our industry, and one you know better probably than anybody else out there, it's normally not a good separation. It's hard to come back to somebody.
Right.
And sometimes even if it is a good separation, to kind of, you know, set your prides apart, whether it was a team or the rider, and then mingle back together, it's really hard to do.
Yeah,
you're
right. I mean, honestly, I thought the same thing in the beginning of the year when I saw, you know, and they send out who's going to be on what team. I was like, oh, check that out, you know, because do you know exactly what year he rode for PC originally? Because I know it was a while back,
no,
and
I
his
don't.
Performance was really inconsistent, and you know, whatever happens, like you said a moment ago, does he fire? Did he quit? Did he get a better deal? Who knows? But I mean, most people don't leave Pro Circuit because they want to.
Right.
Most times.
Right.
You know, I wouldn't say always, but most times, you know. I mean, honestly, I remember in my heyday, the one year that I rode for Factory Husky, I was like, man, just put a great year in, because I honestly wanted Mitch Payton to see me. You know, that was literally everything I thought about. You know,
and unfortunately, the equipment doesn't get any better.
Right, and unfortunately, that year for me turned out to be a disaster year, because I broke three bones in one year. So, but anyway, so congrats on the championship, Justin Hill. That was awesome. I'm sure his brother was completely stoked, you know, because his brother had a long, tough career, injuries, and being all over the place team wise. So great to see that.
And now working for Monster Energy, Josh Hill.
Mm.
So, you know, as a, I believe he is a rider support person. So I think he works directly with all the sponsored riders who.
Okay, awesome.
Justin Hill.
Yeah.
A sponsored Monster Energy rider. So he's definitely putting one up on the you know, mark on the chalkboard there for Monster Energy. And, you know, it's pretty cool to see his interview because I think he is truly grateful of the second chance that he got.
Mm-hmm.
And last night in his interview, you know, he said, I really wanted to get this for Mitch Payton to put it in that empty spot.
Right.
And I kind of almost took that as like, hey, going back to what I didn't do for him the first time, that empty spot. And right, that's right. How I interpreted it. I don't know sure. If he was just talking about this year's or what, but that's how I interpreted it.
You're right. So many people don't ever get to change the what it should have been.
Right.
You know, so that's really cool to see that happen. You're absolutely right. Not many times, especially in a sport like motocross. You know, yeah. It's a short sport for a lot of people.
Super short.
You know, I mean, yeah. You're in and out. Unfortunately, you're injured a lot. You know, all that stuff. So, yeah.
And speaking of injuries, I couldn't find out anything. I don't know if what the outcome was, but a man, probably the fastest man in the 250 class in Salt Lake City, Aaron Plessinger, the number 23 aboard that Yamaha,
yeah, was nobody was saying out. Anything about that.
No.
Yeah.
No. And if I don't know if our, maybe while our executive director it gets the sound, maybe he'll see if he can scoop something up for me and check out, see if we can get an injury.
How about update. Any of you Facebook followers?
Yeah.
Any everybody information on Facebook, for us?
You know. Check out and let us know what happened to Aaron Plessinger, yeah. Number 23 on the Yamaha, as he comes through that whoop. That whoop section was pretty gnarly.
Yeah, and he was killing it.
He was.
Yeah.
And it killed him.
Yeah, absolutely. Good
not
point.
Only did it kill him, yeah. I don't know if you've seen the Forkner crash.
Oh, yeah.
Which was a little weird.
Forkner's had that same crash 3 times now. That exact same crash where he hits a whoop and the bike almost goes backwards for a moment.
Yeah.
You notice that?
Yeah, because it's yeah. The front end's so stiff. But mm-hmm. It really wasn't his fault. It was, you know, he was coming up on a lap rider and right. The lap rider came over mm-hmm. And he slowed down. And as soon as he slowed down, he dropped that front end down and it was over. Luckily, he was able to get back up and get back going. Man, we see all you guys, Cousin Michael, Carrie Blackledge, Hunter Hawkins, all you guys are on there. We're going to get to you. If you guys got questions, let us know. Justin Starling coming up here in just a few minutes. So if you got a question for him, post it up on Facebook Live. If you're on Instagram, you're over there. We don't have a video monitor for you, so we can't see what you guys are writing. But we will check it after the show. So, yeah. So a solid performance by Aaron Plessinger. Unfortunately, not able to finish the race. And
Bobby Williams says, I think it's a shoulder.
Think it's a shoulder.
Well, he had a shoulder injury coming into this.
Yep.
He was dealing with. What I thought was interesting is, you know, when he crashed, if you watch when he did that slow-mo, it literally didn't look like he hit anything. He landed flat on his back, so I thought he just knocked the wind out of himself back. But then when they picked him up, he looked like his left arm and even like his hip, it looked like it was all mangled. But I don't think he could have fell any better through a whoop section.
No, you're right, because he missed all the whoops and landed on his back, and I thought the same thing.
What's up, Jake?
Jake Rakes on there. And that's Bobby from Pro Action Suspension. So make sure you give you guys a shout out. Hey, don't forget to share us. You know, if you guys are on right now, just click the little share button. How about Cody Smith, mm-hmm. Mr. Emergency himself, number 911, coming back. what about Shane McElrath?
Yeah, what a phenomenal talent and just put it all together.
Amazing.
I think this was for him and his, well, I mean, probably a lot of riders think this, but they're like, I got to do it this year.
Yeah.
Because there was a little anticipation. Years past, didn't quite meet that expectation, and it's just awesome to see him coming through from where he's at.
I couldn't agree with you more. I mean, it was
hello, mom. My mom jumped.
There
on
you side. Go. I couldn't agree with you more. And then the TLD guys going 1-2.
Yeah.
And with Justin Hill getting the third place finish, as you know, he wins that title there.
Those guys must be all good buddies.
They are.
You see when they all came off, literally it was like a hug fest.
It was. Yeah. They celebrated.
And then Martin, you know, he rode off with the poo-poo.
What did you think of Martin?
I was actually surprised that he got aggressive right at the end of that main because I don't think we almost ever see Martin ride mm-hmm. like that, have we? I can't remember ever, you know. But
normally, here's my thoughts on Martin. The first 5 laps, he's going to be fast and aggressive. Right.
If he gets a good start.
Yeah. And then the second half, the last third of the race, he's going to fade. Well, when Hill was trying to wrap up his championship, he did complete opposite. I mean, he went in hard.
Right.
And he actually passed Hill back.
I saw
that. Or he passed Hill right there on the last lap, I think three corners to go. And then, what did Hill? So Hill jumped on through the rhythm section and went
outside.
Well,
he went wide right before the finish.
And, you know,
I couldn't believe that Martin, if he would have moved over 2-3 inches, that pass wouldn't have been able to be made. So
at least he was kind of respectful, I guess.
Well, but I'm saying he was clearly ahead.
Mm-hmm.
He wouldn't even have known he was there. He just would have moved over thinking, okay, if this guy's coming around the outside, I'm going to close it off. But
yeah, I agree. And as we keep talking about this, we're going to phone in Justin Starling here in just a second. But Martin Davalos got fourth place. Mm-hmm. Jimmy D, fifth place.
Yeah.
Another solid ride by Jimmy D. And then Austin Fortner into that sixth place even after that crash.
Right.
So...
And then, what about the new JGR guy that everybody was questioning?
Caden Altenith or whatever?
Yeah, I didn't want to say his last name, but you go ahead.
Yeah, I'll screw it up. I screw names up every weekend, so there's nothing different for me.
I don't know this kid. I mean, not a lot of people do, but hey, he got in the main event. He got a 13th place. That's solid, you know?
We're going to dial up Justin Starling here, see if we can get him on the phone as we talk about this.
Yeah, I want to ask him about that LCQ. Because that was awesome.
Dude.
Yeah.
Hello?
Justin.
How's it going?
Hey, man. Welcome. We got Justin Starling on the phone here on the Motostop Show, episode 22.
Justin, what's up, Justin?
In studio, I got Damien Plotts with me. How you been, dude?
Pretty good. Just racing motorcycles, you know, staying all
stuff. Man, just living the dream, right?
Yeah, trying.
Hey, so we were just talking about the 250 Salt Lake, Utah. First, let me get your thoughts on the track. What did you think of the track? How was it? Anything in particular you liked or you didn't like?
I mean, it was a smaller stadium, so the track wasn't very big and kind of one line, but I don't know. I mean, the only thing that was kind of a bust, I guess, was the fact that the rhythms were, I mean, they're all the same. So everyone did the same rhythm the whole time. There was really no way to make up time unless you're good in the loops or in the corner. So, I mean, that was kind of a bust, but it was all right. I mean, the elevation wasn't playing a role. It's the fact that our bikes were extremely slow, but yeah, I thought it was okay for what they had.
Sweet. Awesome. Those whoop sections were pretty gnarly. I mean, it claimed a lot of riders throughout the night, and you are a pretty fortunate one that didn't get caught up in them. Did you have any plans going into it? Were you skimming? Were you jumping? What was your method through the night?
So I was skimming until about maybe lap six of the main, and I snagged a tough block and wrapped my shifter around my foot peg, so I was stuck in first gear. So, yeah, there was no more skimming when that happened. It was just pretty much just trying to jump through them.
You said you were stuck in first gear?
Oh.
Yeah.
Holy shit. Wow.
Yeah, man. Hey, Justin, Damien here, man. I just was telling CJ how I met you a couple weeks ago out at Blake's place, and I thought you were an awesome dude. And I was so pumped to see your last chance qualifier win because I was a little bit concerned, and I know you were concerned after about the second lap, and all of a sudden you went from like fifth to first within, what, three turns or something? It was crazy.
Yeah.
That was awesome.
That was... We've been kind of struggling with some power off the start, and we made some changes, and I can't say they were any good. You know, the changes I don't think were very good for us, and yeah, my starts were not very good, and I put myself in a bad situation in the heat race, crashing twice, and yeah, we in the LCQ, I got a bad start, and I don't know how far back I really was because I was kind of stay out of the chaos, and I jumped the finish line the first lap, and I mean, I was probably 10th, you know, and I know, like, I watched it on TV last night, and it says I was 13th going across the stripe, so I was, you know, I was pretty far back, and I was nervous, honestly. I was I was more nervous at the fact that those guys in LCQ that are back there that far are usually pretty squirrely, and I remember looking at the thing last night, I was the only two-digit rider in the LCQ, so, I mean, I definitely didn't, you know, need to be there. And, I kind of panicked, and, you know, I kind of got hung up about lap two with another rider that was pretty much just trying to go for takeouts instead of, you know, actually race the track. And once I got through him and was able to get another pass, I pretty much just started picking him off and having one lap of just the first, so that was that was cool, and then I ended up winning the thing by a little over 2 seconds. So
nothing better than a checkered flag, dude.
Yeah, right? A win's a win. I don't care where it's at.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I never want to have to win an LTQ, but I mean, if you're going to win something, you might as well win that if you can't get a heat race or a pain, you know?
If you're going to be in it, you better win it, right?
Yeah, I mean, hey, they don't say anything, but it's cool to always go up a podium and at least, you know, say something.
Hey, I was just curious. I lost my microphone.
That's all right.
Oh, okay. Keep going. I was just wondering, how about the bike, man? How slow were they out there? Was that rough for you?
Yeah, they were pretty bad. I mean, it wasn't absolutely miserable, but it was. You could definitely notice it, you know, when it came to the finish line. We had a pretty big triple, and I honestly don't know why they decided to build a triple for the finish line. And as big as they made it, and the fact that it was right out of the corner. I mean, it was the closest one to the corner we've had all year.
Right.
I don't think they really thought about elevation in 250s because, I mean, in practice I saw not more than a handful of guys casing and crash. And, I mean, I remember in the free practice I only jumped it one time because it was just so gnarly and I barely even made it the one time I did it. So they weren't really smart on that, and I was pretty bummed out. But, yeah, it was, I mean, you could notice it. There's no doubt about that. It wasn't like you could ignore it and be like, oh, the bike didn't tap that. The bike was pretty slow, but...
Yeah,
it was slow for everyone. He just had to deal with it.
Right. I remember back in the day, I raced Denver and even Reno, and it was just terrible, man. I remember wanting to hit some of that stuff, like almost wanting to shift the first gear because I didn't think I was going to make it.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
Exactly. Yeah, no, it was nerve-wracking, but luckily the rhythms, none of them are very big. So right. We were able to... you know, just pretty much get through those the best we could. It's just that one triple was the only part where we were, everyone on the 250 class, I think, was kind of like, oh, man, you know?
Yeah.
Hey, and we're live on my Facebook page right now, Justin, and hopefully this is our first phone interview with Facebook Live. So if you guys on there, if you could, if you guys can hear Justin Starling, just let us know. Make sure he can be heard clearly. But if not, make sure you check it out on the motostopshow.com. So I know you got plans to move out to Colorado. Walk us through that and what's going on with your program.
Yeah, so I'm outdoors for me. I mean, I don't have like not many teams do outdoors anymore. Honestly, I mean, unless you're like a Geico or something like that, they just don't do it. And I understand why. There's no money in it, and it just costs more money than anything. And yeah, it's just for me. I mean, I've done it on a team. I've done it as a privateer, and they don't make enough.
Right.
To balance what I put into the weeks, you know, of training and riding, and, you know, why do I put my body through that if I'm not making anything? You know, like, it doesn't make sense to me, and, you know, I'm in this sport because I love it, and I want to race for as long as I can, and every year, I always say that every year you do outdoors, you eliminate 1 year of racing. You know, because it destroys your body during the summer and putting in the motos and all that. So, yeah, this summer I'm just going to, you know, do something different. Go to Colorado. There's like a supercross series out there that pays, I mean, honestly, it pays better than the supercross races we do now. So I'm going to go do that and, you know, work on training and my cardio and get an altitude and expand my lungs a little bit, you know.
Awesome.
Do something different. Just try to switch it up a little bit. I mean, I'm 24 years old, so kind of getting up there, and I want to make sure these last couple of years I really, you know, put in the work. So just going to do something different and head to Colorado and, you know, enjoy my life and also make sure that when it comes time for next year, you know, we're that much further ahead.
Awesome. I love it, dude. And we're on board, and we're going to follow your progress as you go up there and hopefully win that title or whatever that series is up there. I also got on my notes here. I wanted to ask you, they just came out with a 250 rule change. And, I mean, this doesn't directly reflect or affect you, but it kind of does. And I put some thought in this. Are you familiar with the rule change they just did?
Yeah, it was talked about all weekend. Because obviously, Davalos was getting ready to point out over the weekend. So, I mean, it was talked about a lot, and, I mean, personally to me, I agree with it, just for the sense of, I mean, there's guys that, you know, that I would have to move up, you know, like Savachi and stuff, that those guys I just don't think are ready, you know, I mean, it's a really big step to go to the 450 class, and you know, it's kind of not fair to have to go if you're not ready for it, you know. And I'm not saying Savatgy wouldn't go and not just absolutely kill it, because I do believe he would be very good, but he's only been racing his life class for a couple of years or 3 years now, you know, and I don't see a reason why those guys should have to move up. I mean, Davalos, like, everyone hits on him for being in the life class for so long, but he did an interview on it with, I think, Pulp or something, and he said, why would I go race privateer 450 when the past 12 years I've been given a factory contract race at 250? I agree. Like, why would you go do that? You know, stay on the 250 or you're getting paid and you have a factory bike and it's easy, you know? And I don't know. It's a bittersweet to some people. Some people hate it. Some people love it. I agree with it. I think it's good, you know, but, you know, everyone's different.
Yeah, absolutely. And so here's my thought, and I agree with you. Like, obviously, you know, I look at as a motocross rider, mm-hmm. supercross rider, as a business. So Martin Davalos is a business, and he's found a way to make money for himself. But on the other hand, and I was thinking about this today, knowing you were coming on the show, I was like, you know, if, say, those, you know, three riders, Hill, Savatgy, Davalos, and I think there may have been one more that was on the verge of pointing out or needing to move up.
Zach, or no?
I don't know if Zach's close enough, okay. But I think it would open up, you know, fresh spots for riders. Like, I mean, you could very easily step into one of those spots, Justin. I mean, you got the talent, you got the skill. So, you know, it would open up fresh spots for other people, per se. That was the other side of it. Now, I agree with 100% what you said, but just looking at it from the other side, I see both sides, and, you know, I think change is good, and I think we're going to see a lot of change in the 2018 series coming up. So I guess we got to stay tuned to watch, but I definitely appreciate your opinion and glad you shared it with us and the insight of a racer racing in the 250 class now. Mm-hmm. And
yeah, I mean, I could be like, you know, selfish and be like, yeah, those guys should just move up, you know, but at the end of the day, I mean, it's like, I want to earn a spot, not have to get one because other guys got bumped out. You know, like that's kind of like my thing. And you know, I work hard, and you know, and I'll end up getting there. I'll get there one day. I mean, there's no doubt about that. I'm 11th at points right now in the lights class. If people really understood, like, I haven't even done a day of testing yet. You know, and
wow,
I haven't. I've rode two different brands. You know, I practiced on a KTM race, a Husky. If people knew what I was doing on what I'm doing, they would be shocked, you know? I mean, because it's kind of mind-blowing. It kind of shocks me sometimes. Like, I just always think, like, and even I was at the ranch today, and Blake was saying, like, dude, imagine what you could do with, like, 2 months of testing and no program changing, like, switching teams. You know, just, like, think about how good you could do. And it's like, yeah, I mean, think about it. I'm pretty much going off talent and the fact that I'm, you know, I'm in shape, but I haven't done any testing. I haven't done one day of suspension testing yet. I mean, it's nothing, not even a motor testing or anything. So, I mean, to be 11th in points and only 3 points out of 10th, you know, if I could get in the top 10, you know, in Vegas and you know, have people kind of understand, like, you know, that the fact that what I've been doing it and how I've been doing it, that they'd be mind blown, you know. I mean, last week I only rode for probably 30 minutes, you know, in between Seattle and Salt Lake. People don't know that. They probably thought I was in Florida just hammering out photos, but I only rode 30 minutes, you know? Like, that's it.
Wow, that's incredible. So
yeah, I mean, it is what it is. I do think, but, you know, that's, you know, it's not here or there. It's a lot of who you know and stuff like that, but
it
part
is.
Of the game, you gotta go with what you're given and make best with, you know, what you got, because, I mean, I'm very, very, very grateful to have a team that supports me, and I can go racing a motorcycle every weekend, you know, and, you know, I have no complaints.
There you go. And we got a bunch more people coming on Facebook Live, so just want to give you guys an update. We got Justin Starling on the interview via phone, and he's brought to you by grindmx.com. Pretty cool website out there. You guys make sure you check it out. He is the grind reader. Grind rider. Every week we pick a different rider. Justin, you may be familiar or not familiar. I know you jump in our chats quite often, and we appreciate you following the Motostop show. But every week we pick a different rider that you know, stood out to us, whether it's at a local event or on the pros. And one of two riders came to my mind, and with your, and I didn't even get to see the LCQ. I don't know if they played. I'm assuming they didn't play in the first aired video, because right. Damien said he seen it
last night.
But I went back on my DVR and I tried to watch it. And when you were asking if anybody had a video, I was going to post it up for you, and they didn't have the 250 LCQ on that one. So maybe they reversed the roles when they re-aired it. So I still haven't yet to see it, but I seen the times and I seen Damien talk to me about it. And he said, dude, you went from like fifth in the LCQ to first in a few laps. And like you said, two turns, and it's squirrely and sketchy to say the best in any LCQ. So you are a grind rider of the week. So huge props, man. We appreciate you coming on here. Damien, anything else you got for Justin? We told him 15 minutes. I don't want to hold him too long.
Yeah, no. I mean, I just wanted to say congrats, man. And it was a pleasure meeting you a couple of weeks back. And I wish you the best of luck, man.
Hey, yeah, I appreciate it. Good meeting you. I mean, I've heard about you in the past and everything. So to see you at the ranch was cool, you know.
Right on, man.
Who, you're talking about your team, and I know you switched teams. So walk us through that real quick before you jump off and give some shout outs to your sponsors, man.
Yeah, no, I did a team change after round four, just because the other team it was a lot of promises and a lot of stuff that was written down, and basically it split short all the money they were getting for the team. They were just putting in their pockets, and once we found that out, they weren't willing to help me and do what they say they were going to do and do what was in the contract. And once that pretty much happened, I had another team like asking me to ride their bike, and I was just pretty much like, all right, you know, whatever, like, I'll do it. So I made a switch over to JNC Husqvarna, and I mean, it was a pretty easy switch from the KT to the Husky. You know, it wasn't a big change, really. And the only thing that's different is really like the subframe. So it was a pretty easy transition. And actually, I rode it for about 30 minutes on Wednesday, and then I went to Oakland minutes. And got eighth, which was my best ever. So, you know, it's a good team. The people behind them are really good, you know, and they're really supportive, and they're willing to do whatever they can to help me. And, you know, that makes it a lot easier for me, you know, when I show up on the weekend and I'm not having to stress about, you know, what do we have for the parts or for anything like that for the bike. It's, I know I show up, the bike's ready to go. I go do my job and then hop on a flight back home. So, yeah, the team's been really great. I'm hoping to stay with them for next year, and just, you know, keep plugging away, and hopefully next year, you know, what we're talking about right now is basically taking the summer and doing a lot of testing with the bike and developing the bike, because the Husqvarna is not changing for 2018. It's going to stay the same bike, so they want to develop it the best they can for the summer, or during the summer for Supercross next year, so we have a good chance at, you know, maybe cracking the top five. And who knows, maybe if, you know, the cars align, things go well, maybe we can't crack the podium or something like that. So,
sweet.
Yeah, it's a great team, great people, and I'm super, super stoked to be a part of it.
That's what I'm talking about, man. And Ron Davis says, tell him his Aunt Betty says hi. So I don't know if you have an Aunt Betty or Ron Davis is messing with us on Facebook Live, but either way, we said it. But definitely we'll be following you, Justin, man, and the best wishes to you. Anytime you want to come on, just let us know. We'll try to get you some support. I know you're a Florida boy. We're Florida people, and we love keeping it local down here in Florida. So, yeah,
congrats. I'll be taking a couple of trips back from Colorado. Like, I'll be back here quite a bit, you know, maybe for a week or two or something. So maybe I'll have to swing through, and instead of doing it over the phone, I can be there.
Dude, you let me know when you're coming in. We'll make it happen.
All right, cool.
So, all right, Justin Starling, we appreciate it, man, and we'll talk to you next time. Good luck in Vegas, bro.
Thanks, guys.
All right, folks, we just wrapped up Justin Starling there. Man, what a great interview. What a great kid. And yeah. You know what's cool is we didn't know the backstory of what Justin was going through, like he just told us. I mean, mm-hmm. 30 minutes before he went and raced that bike. Now, you give you a bike and say, hey, you're going to go race it in 30 minutes. What do you say?
Well, you know what's interesting? I had a very similar career.
Of course you did.
I raced for, you know, a lot of great people, but I raced for a lot of people that didn't come through, and things were changing around constantly. Actually, I just saw some people on Facebook saying, think of what he could do if he had this or that. I remember, go back 15 years or even 10 years, I had people saying the exact same thing to me. And I remember the day that I got on the Babbitt's Kawasaki team.
Yep.
That I was like, okay, well, this is pretty much the best equipment for the, at least the arena cross series.
Right.
You know, and I'll tell you something, I think that I did well that year. Won some rounds, you know, was competitive to try to win the championship, you know. So it definitely makes a difference. And sometimes it's not even the difference of just the bike being better. It's the difference in you feeling about yourself. Your mindset's right.
Confidence.
Your focus, well, yeah, your confidence, but your focus on the right things, not the wrong things.
Right.
You know what I mean? Not what am I going to race next weekend, but, you know, how am I going to work on my lines and my fitness and my starts and, you know, so, you know, I wish Justin all the best. He's a good dude. And, but unfortunately, there is too many riders in this sport with great talent that are in that same situation.
There is. But he's, what you know do? What? I like what he said. You know, I don't want it handed to me. I want to work for it.
I'm
going to grind to get it. Shout out to grindmx.com. he's going to be on, he is the grind rider of the week. But yeah, man, what a killer. He's going to go up to Colorado, invest into himself, get ready, mm-hmm. train at altitude. Maybe you can sneak in with the Tomax.
I was thinking the same thing, yeah. They're in a weird place in Colorado. I know. But I mean, it's way out in the down south.
Can you imagine John Tomac and Eli Tomac come home and Starling's just ripping around the track?
Can I bring up a story about Tomac quick with training?
Yeah.
I'll be
we
real quick.
We've got 4 hours. We can do whatever we want to do. Well,
my wife's over there going, wait, how many hours?
She's going to start unplugging cameras.
That's right, that's right. So it's interesting. You see the trend for the last 10 years in this sport? What's everyone do? They follow Alden Baker's plan. At least they try to. You see everybody riding road bikes.
Yeah.
I want to make a prediction, everybody. Plotts MX said this. Come next year, everyone's going to be mountain biking and CrossFitting big time.
Yeah?
Yeah.
I think it started to go that way, but...
Well, I always believe that. Yeah. I wasn't a fan of the road bike.
Yeah.
I remember I road biked way back in 2001, 2002 a little bit, and I kept almost getting killed. My car's on the road. I'm like, I'm over this. And the mountain bike, I felt like I was on my dirt bike. I was doing stuff. I was manualing, you know. And nowadays, my kids race BMX, and I go do that with them, and that's cool. You know, I really enjoy that.
Obviously, I'm not a professional
that's
fitness.
That's my prediction.
Okay, and I like it. Plotts MX said it first right here on the Motostop show. So I'm not a professional athlete, and I'm definitely not in the best shape, especially after just eating that piece of pizza that we did not have. But I'll tell you, when I do train and get ready for a race, mm-hmm. I find, like, I go to the gym a lot, and I'm pretty, pretty good at my program. But I find the elliptical, I feel like, gets me better than riding a road bike. Mm. Because I'm working my arms back and forth.
Sure.
Full movement and my legs versus you get on a road bike and you crouch over. You have no movement in your upper body besides your torso here, you know, pedaling. But the rest of your arms are here or maybe here or here or there. Or that's what you kind of move. I mean, you're not getting a workout.
Right.
But like you said, a mountain bike, you are pulling, maybe jumping, pushing, moving. So CrossFit, I know we're probably going to get, you know, hate mail by saying this, but CrossFit is one of the best workouts I believe you can do because it trains your whole body in a motocross.
I think it's wonderful, yeah.
John Morenberg says, CJ, you are in good shape, a good round shape. That's my boy John right there, so I gotta laugh. But I'm definitely in a good round shape right now. I was on the downward trend, but I'm going back up. So let's jump into the 450 main event here.
All right.
And talk, I guess we gotta start with breaking out the beginning of the race and Tomac's start.
Tomac's start, man. Yeah,
horrible.
I'm going to tell you something. That dude's heart rate was 200 for the last two laps, or first two laps of that race, I almost guarantee it. And it might have been 210 by the time he was into the first turn because of that.
You're not kidding. Yeah. So as everybody knows, I listened to a bunch of podcasts, and on the Pulp and Meg show yesterday, they were saying they had Adam Intenap on there. And Intenap was saying, it was weird. Like, I go into the corner, and I knew I had a bad start. And then I look, and Eli Tomac is right next to me, and I'm like, wait, what's he doing back here?
Yeah.
So second, there was only two guys behind him into that first corner.
Crazy.
You're going into a championship battle tied.
Mm-hmm.
What does he do? How did he mentally steady himself and get to the front of the pack like he did?
Well, in my opinion, let me back up one step.
Okay.
I think his maturity, his training, his breathing, everything came into play when he went into that first turn. Because the reason why he was almost, what, there were two guys behind him, you said?
Two guys.
He probably could have came in there maybe in 10th. But he was like, you know what? My championship right here in this first turn could get ruined. So he said, you know what? I'm going to make sure I get through here. I think that's what happened right there. That was the first thing.
I he watched it a bunch of times. I don't think, dude, he, that, and he
I know
said,
he wasn't up there, but I'm saying he started backing off. He could have pushed the envelope and muscled his way through. But I'm saying, that's a risky move.
Right.
You got one guy just falls on the front of you and you're done. So I think that was maturity. Now, to answer your question, throughout the moto, I think at that capable or that talented rider, that type of rider, at that moment, I think it's all about you rely on what you did last week, what you did all season. Obviously, he's at the peak of his training. Probably, I don't know, it'd be stupid to say he's at the peak of his ride. I've heard a lot of people say that, but, you know, what do you know he's going to, who do you know what he's going to be in a month or two?
Yeah.
But what I do want to say is he is peaking with his training. You can see he's doing great. He's not rattled by anything. So in my opinion, when he came out of that first turn, he said, okay, it's probably, they already had it figured out. He knew he was going to do 27 laps or whatever it was. So he's like, you know what? I just got to put my head down, ride my race, you know? And I didn't see any moves that were crazy, you know? If anything, when he passed Dungy the first time, but he was too far inside after the rut, mm-hmm. or after the whoops, mm-hmm. and then Dungy got him right back, I swear it looked like Dungy was like, oh, man, I got to get in front of you again. I swear that's what it looked like to me. I was like, wow.
Here we go again?
Yeah, I was surprised by that.
I'll tell you, you what know? Was crazy he was doing is the damn whoop section.
Yeah, yeah. But, I mean, he was just, he had it so good. You know, he was, well, I think he was the only one blitzing it, at least in the middle of that main.
So, in that segment, Dungy's best time was 7.4 or 7.5 okay. seconds. Pretty much from corner to corner. So up right. and over that jump through the whoop section.
Sure.
Can you guess what Tomac's was?
Oh, man. I didn't look at those segment times. But
4.3.
For real?
For real.
Wow. That's crazy.
So that's balls out. That's man. Like balls to the walls. Like, I don't give it.
That is awesome.
I'm coming to, yeah. to win.
Well, you know, honestly, I mean, jumping through the whoops is a tough thing. I mean, everybody kind of knows it that Moosecan, that's his weakness. He tries to jump through most all of them. And you can see every week that he either does it well if the track deteriorates enough, or mm-hmm. he struggles big time when everyone's blitzing him. You yep. know, so Tomac, this was a weekend where it was just gnarly, and he was the guy going, I'm going all the way to lap 27. Was it 27?
I don't know.
Or it might have been 28.
Yeah.
It was a lot of laps.
27. I don't think we did 28 laps yet. John Holler jumped on here. He said Eli has Ryan's number one.
yeah.
I agree with you. He is... Dude, on a different level right now.
I will not make that prediction, though.
What?
Sorry, not that. Because Ryan has been a phenomenal champion. You can't ask any more
Tomac
from that
Tomac rides
guy.
A Kawasaki. What else more could you want?
Well, believe me, and I'm a Cowie guy.
What
yeah.
else more could you want?
But I'm just saying, man, what Dungy's done over the years, I know people have bagged on him because first it was the Alessis beating him. Then all of a sudden it was the Villopotos, you know, but... He's hung in there tough, man, and the guy has won a lot. So you know what? Like Jeff Stanton back in the day when it was him and Bradshaw, you never know what he might pull out the next two weekends.
I agree, and anything's possible. But yeah. what I will say is you take somebody who's as fast as Eli Tomac right now,
mm-hmm.
and up until this point, you could say that Dungy could say, hey, you know, if I do get the start, if this goes right, I could beat him. After this weekend, you can't say that.
Right.
Dungy came out of the first corner in first.
Yeah.
Eli Tomac, besides two people, was dead mm-hmm. last, and he didn't just catch him and pass him at the finish right. line. He caught him and gapped him to, I think, 6.5 seconds. 6.5 seconds.
I was reading what Chris wrote there.
What does it say? Read it out to us. Chris Jeffries. Yeah.
If Dungy wins the championship, what's he say? It is fair to say he earned his plate. And beat the best. Absolutely.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, he...
Well, like I kept saying, you know, it's funny. I thought about this championship the other night. I'm going to age myself when I say this, so don't laugh. 1992, Jeff Stanton and Bradshaw. I don't know of any older generation out there, but Bradshaw was the Tomac.
Right.
He was killing it. It was kind of a little bit flip-flop because Bradshaw killed the whole season. He won like 10 races and Stanton was done.
Right.
And he threw away one race. Bradshaw did. It made Stanton like tied in points.
Okay.
They went into the last race, all Bradshaw had to do. Think about it, a guy that won like 10, 12 races in a season, all he had to do was get like fourth. He went out there and totally choked. Stanton rode his freaking balls off and won by like 20 seconds or something. Bradshaw got fifth or sixth. Lost the championship, you know? And I'm not saying Tomac's going to do that. I'm not a huge fan of either of them. I'm a fan of the sport. I'm a fan of all professional athletes. Well, motocross athletes.
Right.
You know what I mean? So I just want to see a great race, and I love to see what is going on, and I know everybody else does too. You know, the anticipation's awesome.
Yeah, it is, and I'm looking forward. You know, we're heading to New York, New Jersey this weekend.
My home country.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. Now I'm in Florida. I don't get to go to MetLife.
Out there where the Yankees are.
Yeah, well, I don't know about that. I don't watch any baseball.
I was talking about the people, not the baseball team. Oh, yeah, good times here at the Motostop Show. They're headed to Jersey.
I haven't heard that in a while. That's good.
And it should be a showdown. Then going into Vegas, one would have to think that Eli Tomac has the confidence, the momentum, and what it's going to take right now to win this championship. That's where I'm putting my money and projecting my bets right now.
Well, I hope he doesn't put himself in another situation like that with that start.
I mean, I kind of hope he does because I know we talked about
this. The risk level is so high.
High, man. But for me, so if you guys didn't watch the race, it was Salt Lake City, Utah. Came on a little later. Looks like we're getting a call here. You want to answer this? Maybe special guest?
Oh, what we got?
Thank you for calling the Motostop Show.
Hello?
Oh, it sounds like Moto Harris is on the phone.
Moto Harris, you roosted me this weekend.
Oh, our special guest. He couldn't be in studio, so he called in. We got Moto Harris from the Motostop Show right here via the phone. Buddy, what's going on?
Hello?
Can you hear me? Hey, you got to turn off your Facebook.
Oh, you got a big echo.
Hang on, we had to stop the show on the computer.
Yeah, there you go. So, Moto, I wanted to get you on and talk a little bit about your race this weekend at Bosswood Creek MX Park.
The favorite thing was the gate, because I got stuck in the gate.
Yeah, you got stuck in the gate?
Yeah, I tried to get out, but I got out.
Oh, okay. How was it? What did you think of the weekend there at Bosswood Creek?
Cool.
Cool? And there's a lot of people on. I see your grandfather's on, G-Paw, Brent Cannon, your buddy's on. So if you guys got a question for Moto Harris, let us know and we'll ask him.
Hi, everybody.
Hey, dude. Great to hear your voice.
Hey, do you know Damien Plotts? You ever heard of him?
Yeah.
He's here in studio with me.
I know.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
Hey, she's not Damien Plotts. She's Gavin's dad.
Gavin's dad. Yeah, Gavin's dad.
He calls me Gavin's dad. I like that.
Yeah, he wants to go train with Gavin's dad. So every time we talk about Damien, he's like, hey, can we go train with Gavin's dad? He's going to teach me how to stand up and put my legs out in the corners.
That's right.
And I'm like, sure, because obviously what I've been telling you is not working. But hey, he did have a solid ride, the 314 on the PW. Put in some great motos out there with a lot of the rivers.
I couldn't hear
he got a third and a fourth this
third
weekend.
Third and a fourth. Good job, Moto.
It sounds like you have a
brake
alarm.
Oh, yeah?
What do
you say? It sounds like you have a
brake alarm
showing
me. Oh. Hey, Haley and Brianna Mortberg said hello.
So did my mother.
Hi.
And his mother said hello. And Chris Jeffrey said Moto Ride awesome. So, Moto Road awesome, not
Thank
ride.
You.
So, what are you doing, buddy? Are you watching the Motostop Show?
Yes, I can see you.
What do you think? Is it pretty good?
Yeah.
You got any comments? You want us to do anything better?
Yes.
What?
Sitting here just staring at you.
Oh, sitting there just staring at me?
I have a question.
Yes.
I have a question.
Can you see me?
Hey, Damien has a question for you.
I have a question for you, Moto. Why are you not riding a Kawasaki?
They don't make a 50.
They don't make a 50.
You can't get your dad on something like that? Figure that out.
He did tell me he won a new Classics this weekend. He won a Kawasaki Green.
Awesome, yeah.
So, yeah, and Jared Cannon said, hello, buddy.
That's awesome.
Hello.
So, all right, well, we're not going to keep you on here too much. I thank you for calling in. We got to talk about the 450s. Hey, did you get to watch the 450 race?
Yes.
Who do you think, who won?
Tomac
won?
Yes.
Do you think he's going to win the championship?
Yes.
Hey, you remember,
did you look on your checklist?
Did he what?
Did you look on your checklist?
Oh, yeah, yeah. I looked on my checklist right here. Hey, and Jason Anderson got third place.
Oh, you like Jason Anderson, right?
Yeah.
But I like Jason Anderson.
He tells me, like, we're watching the race the other day, and he goes, hey, Jason Anderson, third place. Can you believe Jason Anderson's in third place? I'm like, and I look up, and Jason Anderson was in third place. I'm like, oh, no, I can't really believe he's in third place.
There you go.
But wasn't even paying attention, and Moto showed me where he was at. So, all right, buddy, we're going to finish talking about the 450s and wrap this show up. I appreciate you calling in, okay?
Okay.
Love you.
Bye, everybody.
Bye. See ya. All right, special guest Moto Harris there calling in. All the superstars calling in tonight. We got Starling, Moto Harris.
That's awesome.
What else could you want? Donnie Shive from Team Shive just jumped on.
Sweet.
He's been working on a pretty nice bagger. He is an old-time stunner, motocrosser. He's got a really fast up-and-coming superstar of a kid on 85, the Super Mini, Aiden Shive. And he just got himself a nice Harley. And he's pimping it out. It's pretty nice. I've been following the progress, Donnie. Can't wait to see that thing painted in a few weeks. So, Jason Anderson, a solid ride, the best ride of his the year, I believe, and third place finish.
Are you sure? I thought he was on the podium earlier.
Did he? I don't know.
Maybe not. Anyways, that doesn't surprise me much. I think he's a phenomenal ride. I really thought he would have actually. I was surprised he's gotten a couple good starts this year and faded back to like fourth or fifth. And that surprised me more because you remember last year, he never did anything but move forward every race.
And aggressive, too.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I haven't seen that aggressive riding style out of him.
Tomac's really gotten his head because I've seen him at least three races I can think of pass him. Tomac passed Anderson pretty aggressive.
Yeah.
Now kind of, you know, Anderson's kind of like, oh, here he comes. All right, move on.
You seen him stand up in that corner after the loop section. He definitely did know he was coming, and he stood up and definitely checked up. Marvin Muskin, another solid ride. And Marvin had a bad start, too. It was actually a few bikes in front of Eli Tomac.
Did you see when he came out of the gate?
Fourth.
It looks like he ran in. I forget who was on the left of him, but it literally looked like he ran into him. Like he just, his whole bars pulled this way. Yeah, it was a weird, weird deal. He looked like Mike Gavin this weekend when he came off the gate at Bostwick.
Hey, how about the fifth place guy right there?
Oh, yeah. That was awesome to see Josh. I was so pumped to see that he was second fastest in qualifying. I was like, oh, man, amazing. That's great. Yeah, I mean, he's another one of those riders that any weekend he could be a top guy. Then the next weekend he's 19th. And you can't figure out why that is. You know, it's
very inconsistent his whole career.
Yeah.
And I think that's what's plagued him. But Josh Grant, the Monster Energy Kawasaki, putting in a solid ride, fifth place. The Australian there in sixth place.
Mm-hmm. Chad Reed.
Mm-hmm.
He was kind of a silent sixth place, you know, because I don't think they talked about him once in Maine, that I remember at least.
Dude, I know I said this all the time, but go down and look. You know, we were making fun of Barsha or talking about Barsha earlier. I'll make fun of Barsha, and you were just talking about him.
Yeah, yeah.
But
I didn't see this part of the race.
I don't know. I've seen a few bits, but I heard a bunch of interviews. Justin Barsha and Malcolm Stewart T-boning each other, going at it back and forth, and they're in 16th place.
Right, right.
Like, what the hell? You got to think about your health, your career. Like, you can't be riding like that every... It doesn't matter if Justin Barsha's going for last place.
Mm-hmm.
He's probably going to T-bone you if he goes around you. Like, it's insane. He went. I mean, I know his name's Bam Bam, but he used to pass, you know, with a little bit of an aggression, but not like I'm going to kill you. Now I feel like it's straight going to murder everybody.
But at least when he was making those passes a few years ago, it was for the lead or for a podium.
And he was fast.
Right.
Yeah.
The whole 15th, 16th place is
insane.
I don't even want to have an opinion on that because I'm lost. You know, I just was talking to a guy the other day through Instant Messenger, and he thinks it's the bike, you know, but then everyone's got this opinion, the bike. I don't know. You know, I mean.
Well, I mean, Blake Baggett's not on the Suzuki anymore.
Yeah.
Brock Tickle, no? Yeah, Brock Tickle's on the Suzuki.
Cooper Webb, that's another little bit of a bummer. You know, I would like to have seen him up there. We don't have.
So that's what I was getting to my point. I'm glad you brought that back up. So, Cooper Webb, ninth place.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd like to see him up there, too. But look at that rundown. Like, up where? Eli Tomac, Ryan Dungey, Jason Anderson, Marvin Musquin, Josh Grant, Chad Reed, Davey Millsaps, Blake Baggett. I mean, is Cooper Webb better than all those guys? I mean, maybe, but not really.
Any given weekend.
Yeah, but all those guys are freaking amazing. Then keep going. Yeah. How about Dean Wilson, Christian Craig, a solid ride on that 450, Factory Connection 450 there?
Mm-hmm. I wonder how he physically took the 27 laps or whatever it was. You know what I mean? Because he's not used to that. Used to the bigger bike, and he's a bigger dude. You know, he's a tall guy. I don't know how tall he is, but.
And they didn't show him much on TV?
No.
Well, I'd say if he, if he settled in and he didn't push too hard, he might have just managed his race, and he'd probably been okay. Christine says we need to get my mom on. Yeah, I agree. Hey, don't forget, we're going to do Facebook shout-outs and comments, so you guys got questions, put them on there. You can find us at Instagram, Big Deal Productions, The Motostop Show. You can also find us iTunes, Stitcher, TuneIn. We do weekly podcasts, so even if you can't have time to watch on here, you can download our podcast. And I got to give a big shout-out. We're not done yet, but I got to give a big shout-out to The Big Deal Productions for making all this happen week in, week out. And again, for Plotts MX, we're going to have our Plotts MX little see if you got an idea of maybe we can make some of these guys a little faster. Dave Freeze put in a solid ride out there at Bosswick Creek. We're going to talk a little bit about a local series, Bosswick Creek, here in just a minute.
Yeah, Brown, Florida,
anything
Georgia.
Else you see on the 450s that you want to touch on?
Alex
Ray putting that Rock River ride up there in 18th place. Adam Entenapp, solid ride in 19th place. Nick Schmidt in the 20th. Justin Bogle, and then...
Poor Justin Bogle, man. Have we not seen him... Has he crashed every race?
Every race.
I think so, you know. And he's always been up there. He keeps getting good starts. He rides great for a little bit, you know, but...
He got the whole shot. Oh, Bogle went down...
Oh, he did get the whole shot.
Bogle went down the whoops.
Yeah.
Remember?
Yeah,
so the whoops section, pretty gnarly. It claimed... I did some notes here. Just what I've seen.
Look at this.
Bogle down. Forkner went down in the whoops. Aaron Plessinger went down in the whoops.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's all I've seen.
There was a guy on a Yamaha, and I think it was in the 250 class.
That's Aaron Plessinger.
No, there was a guy laying on the track.
Oh, that was in the rhythm section because...
Oh, I was thinking it was in the whoops because they rode right between the bike and the rider.
Hill jumped over him.
Right?
Yeah, Hill actually jumped over him. So, Bobby Williams, I couldn't agree with you more. He says, Big Deal Team is awesome. Absolutely correct. So,
we got the metal rolls up back here.
Yeah, they're throwing up down there. I'm just making sure. Hey, there you go. Pretty cool. Something funny that I've seen, and you guys that were following along might know, but Steve Mathis from Pulp and Mech Show, he's in the press, the post-race interviews.
I listen to that, yeah.
And as he goes, MXA is I guess a good website, decent reporters. Mathis and them don't get along well, so he makes fun of them a lot. So when he goes to do his interview, he says, "Hey, it's Steve Mathis from MXA." And he asked his question.
He didn't say that.
Yes, he did.
I didn't hear that.
Yes, he did.
Part.
And it was pretty funny. And like as soon as I heard it, I started laughing. And you should have seen Twitter and everything blow up, dude. It was funny.
Oh wow.
So MXA blocked him. But then
they blocked him.
He,
that's awesome.
Like this is MXA's reporting.
Right.
They reported this week.
Yeah.
That Martin Davalos pointed out. Well, Friday.
Well, I even told you that. Yeah.
Yeah, but Friday AMA posted this release that there's a new rule change that it's not going to happen before the race. So just not always great reporting, and I understand you were busy all weekend, so you didn't know what was going on.
I only saw the first report. I didn't see the follow-up.
Yeah, I was pretty fortunate to No, John, the rule is actually the opposite way. So where Davalos, Hill, Savacci, and I think I'm missing one, would have actually had too many points, too many years, and too many championships. It was a kind of a plethora of that combination mm-hmm. made you move up. They changed it now and kind of relaxed it, for lack of better words, to where none of those three guys that I just said meet the criteria to point out of the 250 class now. So very fortunate that Martin Davalos will have another year if he wants it in the 250 class.
People are going to be irate.
We're working
and
on it.
Everywhere I go and they talk about him, man, he doesn't have many fans.
Dude, when he started in the 250 class, he was old enough to buy beer. And when he retires, he's going to be on Social Security.
Yeah. Well, my last pro year was 2008. I took a plane trip with Davalos, not with him, but we were on the same plane to like Indianapolis Supercross. Like yeah. I think that year I was like, wow, that dude's been around a long time.
Yeah. John Mortenberg said, yeah, Martin was going to be pointed out too. No, I thought Martin. I don't think Martin was because he signed on another. Martin's on a 2-year deal. So he couldn't have been pointed out. But
for
huh?
No, I was.
But anyways, so that wraps up our Salt Lake City. What did you think of the track? It was a track?
Typical track, I don't know.
Yeah.
Coming from a guy that when I raced some of those series, I didn't really ever seem to care just because everyone was gonna race the same thing.
Right.
I mean, you heard what I question to Starling. That would have been my biggest concern.
Is the power?
The bike was so slow.
Yeah.
You know, the elevation just kills those bikes, especially in the 250. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and I think they did a pretty good job, the Dirtworks guys, with building the track, knowing the power's going to be down. You know, a hard triple, the whoops were pretty gnarly. It's kind of pretty intense. So
you know what's interesting is
when all Starling, the hearts and smiley faces we're getting across our screen, that's pretty
awesome.
Interesting. Somebody loves us.
Our Starling was saying that the triple was like, what, the first or second one they did all year, and it was actually big right out of a corner, surprisingly, for a track that the bike was slower because of the elevation. Well, it was weird. I talked to some guys that did the Denver Arena Cross last weekend, and, you know, that's even worse at Denver,
right.
I think. They did the same thing. The catapult jump, the finish line jump in the Arena Cross was bigger than some of the ones for the other rounds. And I talked to a couple buddies of mine. Everyone was saying that, like, literally everybody in practice was framing the thing huge. So I'm kind of like, I wonder why they would have done it that way. I don't know, but.
Well, I
so
think.
So who knows? I don't understand that thinking. But
I think it's because they think the 250s don't have enough power to do it. So they want to try to make a separator. So the guys that do have a lot of power on the 250s and really good skilled riders can actually make it. And they're hoping the other guys
even
only
like
double
at Denver,
and single.
You know, I mean, it's just it's a double. So it's like you're not going to not double it. You know?
Well, maybe they should not double it.
Well.
See, that's my problem. I look at something, I'm like, I shouldn't jump it. I go for it, and then
actually,
I'm in the hospital.
One of the guys I talked to, in his last time practice, he told me, he said, every lap he came around there was like four guys in front of him rolling it.
Really?
He got the jump at one lap out of the whole practice.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah. To me, that's just like, you know, I don't see the point in doing it that way, but whatever.
Well, let's do a quick touch on the amateur hour because I know me and you were both at the same location at the same time,
amateur
which is always
hour.
Great. That's right, folks. We got a whole nother hour. Just kidding. We're going to make this one short and sweet. I love when I say it. Everybody's looking around like, what? So, no, we're just going to touch base on a local race we were at. We were at the Florida Georgia Championship with the Florida Motocross Series. A really cool series collaboration came together. Hunter Klein just come and jumped on. He was actually at the race this weekend. John Mortenberg, a lot of you guys were on the race. So I think there was some other race in action. I do apologize because I was there announcing. I didn't do any research or find out. But maybe Poy Dog's on. Maybe he'll tell us about some other racing. I know he'll be covering it. There's always a lot of racing going on in Florida. There's at least 25 series to hit every weekend.
Okay.
But
I'm learning that the more I'm in the Southeast.
Speaking of Poy Dog.
Yeah. Of who dog?
Chase McGram on Instagram. Too Hot Chase with Tot, another youngster that you've been working with.
Chase
He's
with
over
Tot.
There on that camera. Say hi to the number 57.
What's up, my Chase?
I got in my announcing role there for a second. Well, sorry.
He's fired up.
Yeah, NDA
We're
Action
in the middle
Sports.
Of the show and he's fired up.
Poy Dog, he does something really cool on Wednesdays at 8 o'clock. Normally at 8 o'clock he goes live, and that's actually where we got the idea. We were doing our YouTube shows, but I never thought about doing it live, and sweet. Checked out one of Point Dog shows, and it was pretty sick, and now we've been following him, and he's been, you know, promoting us, and we're trying to help promote him, but he covers a lot of local racing reports, so West Coast, and he's got Paul Fleming, another great announcer that covers most of the amateur stuff on the West Coast of Florida, so that's really cool. But back to the Florida-Georgia Championship. It was held at Bostwick Creek. It was round two of the Florida Motocross Florida-Georgia Championship. Mm-hmm. What an amazing turnout we had. What did you think? This was one of your first races you attend, first local races you attend since you've been in Florida? Or?
It was. It was my first one.
So what did you think of the vibe, the environment, the pits?
Well, I mean, it was a packed house.
And if you say anything bad, I'm going to just cut your microphone off.
Yeah. It's right here is going to strangle me. No. I had a great time. It was an interesting weekend for me because, like a lot of people know, my family and I are living out there and we're training full time there. So,
and we appreciate that. So
yeah, and thank you for everybody. You know that I get the good feedback and that's appreciated so much. But what was interesting is we're there all week, so the owner's like kind of like shutting me down middle of the week. He's like, "Look, I need days to prep. I need to okay." So I had to kind of figure that schedule out almost last minute, you know, because I think, you know, he was definitely overwhelmed and he wanted to make sure he put on a good show and all that good stuff. And I thought it all went well. And I helped run the gate all day and that was pretty cool. Talked to a lot of guys, was trying to encourage a lot of the guys that I train. My kids actually raced for the first time, which was an interesting story. You know,
tell us a little bit about it because I was impressed and I thought it was pretty amazing.
Yeah, it was cool. You know, I have an 8 and a 10 year old and they've been around motocross. Both of them started riding at 3 years old and I kind of made a promise to myself and to my wife that I would not push my kids. If they didn't have it in their heart to be motocrossers, they wanted to be gymnasts or whatever it was. That's where I would follow them and I would encourage them and support them as much as I could. Well, so here we are. Tristan's 10 and Gavin's 8, and they still have not shown a lot of motocross interest. We've been living at Bostwick since January, and probably both of them have ridden 5 times.
Really?
Yeah. And my little guy, Gavin, he was on a 50, and I was so over 50s, even wanting to even do it 1 or 2 times. Right. So I just got him on a 65, and he can barely touch the ground. So I got him one of those little lowering kits, and it was interesting because he rode the main track, I think, 3 laps before that race. And the owner, Bernie, was kind of like, "Hey, man, you got to get your boys racing this weekend. You know, they've been here. They're good enough to do it. It's fine." You know, and I asked them both, and they wanted to do it. So we signed them up, and they just both rode the 65 class. And, you know, Tristan did really good. You know, I mean...
They both did amazing.
He's 2 years older, you know, and he got a whole shot in one race, and that was the highlight of his day. He was battling with people all day and had a good time. Gavin, he struggled a little bit, you know, but he never quit. You know, he had a pretty good attitude. He fell down in the first turn, I think, almost every race, poor little guy, and I ran down there and helped him out, you know. So all you dads know what I went through, and that was a little new to me, you know, because my boys have been racing BMX almost on a national level since they were both 4 or 5 years old.
Right.
So all of a sudden they wanted to put the pedal bikes away and we turned the throttle, which, you know, that made me, because I'm an ex-pro rider, been racing motocross since my whole life. And I was like, yeah, let's do this, you know. But deep down, I still want them to do what they want to do and I'll support them. So who knows? Maybe all of a sudden we'll be chasing racing. I don't know.
There you go. I got to ask you. So now, and it may be a little different. Maybe you can go back to your first time you took them to a BMX race.
Mm-hmm.
Did you get any like butterflies when they went to the gate this weekend? Were you excited, nervous, or go back to your first BMX days with mm-hmm. them? Because I'm going to tell you a story after I hear what your thoughts are.
Oh, I had all that, dude.
Yeah?
Yeah, everything. It was kind of funny because I was working the track.
Yeah.
My wife, God bless her, she doesn't know a lot about, you know, let's get the gas turned on, fill it up, check the tires, whatever. So I literally said to my wife Sunday morning, I gave her a high five, and I said, "You got the boys to the line, everything, right?" And she was like this, "Are you kidding me? What?" And Gavin, when he saw that I left, the whole time he was very nervous, Christina, my wife said. And every time I came back to get a drink or anything, he was like this, dad, where do I go? What do I do? You know? So it was, I was trying to make it low key and just fun.
Right.
You know what I mean? I didn't, there was nothing serious about it. We didn't talk about anything else other than, I don't actually train my kids, even though I'm a motocross trainer, had a whole pro career.
Right.
They have joined in a training session one time, and it was last week. Chase Matot came out. I think there was another guy. And I asked the boys, yeah, you guys want to come out and just jump in this training session? They came out. That was the first time they've ever done that. So when they go to that track, it was so new to them, you know. But they both, you know, have all the ability because they've been hearing me talk about it so long. So when you look at them, like I got all these pictures Tom took, thank you very much. And they look like any pro out there riding, but they're just not going that fast.
That's all right. Hey, you got to start somewhere.
But I love them. You know?
So before we get to my story, I got to give Banks MX a shout out. Brandon Loser jumped on, actually the mechanic down there at the Ferry compound. Good friend of mine, Jalik Swole. He's taking him to the top. Over here on Instagram, we got Kerry Blackledge. We got Brax. Little Brax Burns said, what's up, buddy? I haven't seen you at the races. I need to see you. How you been? Also, we got Zoe out there. And Zoe's the little girl, the 321, that had the brakes, I think, malfunction at Bostwick and hurt her shoulder. I heard broken collarbone, Zoe. And
is she on Instagram? Or
she's on Instagram right there.
Yeah. Brandon, Zoe, we wish you the best.
This hat is from you, buddy. I forgot about that. Brandon Loser got me hooked up with this hat. First time he's on, and the first time I wore this hat, maybe good luck.
Wow! So look at that stuff. It's so let not me even tell you my hat.
Go ahead. No, let me tell you my story about my first experience with moto. So at 2 years old, we decided we're going to take them down to this Strider race, this Strider Championship.
Where'd you go?
We went to Bradenton, Florida.
Okay.
It was one of their 3-round championships, mm-hmm. and I didn't know what to expect. Well, I guess it was a big ordeal. Right. We had eliminations and everything.
Right, yeah.
So
qualify down to the main.
Yeah, I'm not a BMX guy. I've never been to BMX tracks. So literally we get down there. We drove them down in the motorhome, and I just put that picture I posted up today with the motorhome. That was actually us going down to his race.
Wow.
So I get him up there, and I put him in line, and I'm talking to him, and I'm like, all right, look, when you come out of the gate, you got to pedal. And if that guy tries to cut in,
you got
to
push.
Push to the inside and block this. Now, as I'm telling, I probably went through about 5 minutes of conversation, and I looked at him, who 2-year-old could barely speak English. I'm like, he doesn't know what the hell I'm saying.
Hey, you know what I was going to say? The dad next to you was probably mad at you.
Yeah.
We don't race that way.
Oh, no. This was very... I mean, before I went, I was told, like, watch out for the people overseas. They're going to be cheating. I'm like, dude, I'm going to race a 2-year-old.
Really?
The only kid that beat moto, I swear, had a driver's license, okay? In the 2-year-old class. This kid ran like an ostrich with his legs. I hope he's not watching, but if you were, dude, you weren't too.
Both my kids did that, and they won a bunch of stuff, too. Yo.
Dude, this kid's, like, his legs were like ostrich. He's like, whew. So finally, when it come to the main, I looked at moto, I said, look, bro, you don't have nothing for that dude. Beat everybody else. You're badass, but that dude is on steroids, so let's just beat the people we could beat.
That's too funny.
So look at everybody posting up and coming on now.
Yeah. What's up,
I just
guys?
Posted a video on Facebook on my Flying W in the Vet C class.
Flying W, yeah.
Steven, dude, had a...
Where'd that happen?
The skier is over the triple.
Oh,
so he comes over, he seat bounces, he's late in the moto, he's tired. He seat bounces and it kicks him like this. Dude, I'm watching the whole thing, panic revved out. Like, I literally thought he was dead. And he saved it somehow.
I was going to 200.
250.
Yeah.
So I was going to talk a lot about the points and stuff, and I wanted to run down some special people in the class. But honestly, the points I got were from the first round. So...
Oh.
We're not going to talk about those, but we will talk about...
I had nothing to do with this show prep.
No, he's just the guest. He just comes in and sits down, and he's the real talent. I'm just the idiot here.
The real talent.
So,
hey, thank you.
So, there was some stuff that I wanted to talk about. Man, there were some great battles. Our 450A class, man, with Jake Rakes, the number 98, and I'm drawing a blank.
I didn't know that. I spoke to I'm guessing it was his dad.
Yeah, damn it.
Good dude.
Guffy. Yeah, Joseph Guffey. Sorry, dude.
Okay, yeah.
Joseph Gunny.
He trains out with Carmichael. That's what his pops told me.
Yep, he is a
good aggressive rider. Yep.
Out at the goat farm. Dana Krause up there, dude. And, dude, there's a bunch of others, and they were throwing down. They literally put a phenomenal show on for us. Mm-hmm. And the open money class, the 458 and the 250. Guffey, there you go, yeah. Nick. Took me a second. You know, all this stuff rambling. We got posts over there, cameras, lights. I mean, people want autographs, and I just can't. No, I'm just kidding. Nobody wants my autograph. Sounded good, though, didn't it? So, dude, Nick, was that not an awesome, awesome battle all day long? All the way down to the peewee class. I mean, there was on the 50 class, I mean, my son got involved with, I believe Gage was his name. Dude, they threw down like you wouldn't believe on the little PWs, and I was so stoked. They came off. They high-fived each other. Blackledge.
Yeah, that was pretty cool.
Another former pro rider, Matt Johnson, jumping on there. MJ up in Colorado, back on a Kawasaki. We got to get him some parts up there. He's going to start riding, get off those damn snowmobiles. But Bruce Kramer said a great weekend of racing. Yeah, and don't forget, May 7th, we head to Dade City Raceway for round three. Going to continue on with some great May 7th, 7th gear. We're going to continue on with another great racing experience. And those of you guys, you know, we're going to check in. Like I said, I didn't have enough time to find out what happened in the local series. We're going to talk about some other ones. But a guy that really covers that, our heart and soul is going to be on the pro show. And then a little bit of the Florida, Georgia, just because my ties with that. But if you definitely want to dive in to the local events, make sure you check out the NDA Action Sports Weekend Race Report, Poy Dog. Right. The 85, what was that, 85, 12 to 15 class was another great battle, as Nick just said.
CJ.
Hey, CJ, I know a guy that can help you.
Starts, man.
This guy right here.
There you go. Perfect.
Or that guy right there. The guy in the black shirt. We'll go that way.
The guy in the black shirt
can help you get your starts dialed in. CJ Rosa right there. We had the whole Rosa team out there. Man, I'm telling you, what an amazing event. We had a lot of sponsors out there, a lot of vendors. I mean, Trackside Treats, the best ice cream money can buy, was right there. So on a hot day, you get a cold snack right there.
I didn't get to try that. I'm so bummed out. Yeah.
You probably didn't need any. I'm just kidding. I have no room to talk. As I hit his belly, I'm like, man, that's way flatter than this round thing. So Larry's Giant Subs.
I'm 10 years older.
And way better looking, but that doesn't matter. So we had Larry's Giant Subs out there, Big Deal Productions, all day long. Big Deal Productions out there hustling the streets and hustling the tracks. They had to split. We had first time ever multiple jobs going on. So half of them had to go film some non-cool stuff. I don't know what he did, but I didn't really care because it didn't have anything to do with moto. The other half came out to moto. It is a big deal.
That's right.
And make sure you guys check out all your photos at BigDealProductions.com. D-Plot starts tips got me
right
a whole
on, Dave.
Shot.
I didn't see that start. I'm bummed, but man,
he did.
Oh, man.
He did have a whole shot.
Rocked it.
We're not going to talk about lap 3, 4, and 5, Dave, but you did have a great start out there. Dave Freeze put in a solid ride on the 109. Yeah. Josh Rosa says, hey, I heard this weekend better to start from last and move up than start from the front and move backwards.
Right on.
That's a CJ Harris tech tip right there.
Perfect.
Let me explain to you guys what I was telling him. And I got this from the Pulp and Mix. I steal 99% of my stuff. Not really, but I love the Pulp and Mix show. And David Billman said a while back, he goes, you know, if you're a fourth place rider and you know that's where you're going to end up, there's no reason to get a good start and fade to fourth place because then you look bad. He said, so get a bad start, move to fourth, and now you're the hero of the day.
Yeah.
Makes perfectly good sense. Now, you do risk the chance there on a 10th place start. You're not going to move to the front place unless you're Eli Tomac.
Well, I told you, it's all the risk level.
Risk versus reward, man.
It's just terrible. Motocross is dangerous enough. Don't make it more dangerous. So forget that technique.
Josh Rosa says,
I don't care if you're a 10th place guy. Get the freaking whole shot.
Yeah, moto should have been 5 laps. Hunter needs starting help.
Right on.
Hey, when I normally go to the gate with Hunter, we do get great starts, but he does need some starting helps. So maybe we check out Damien Plotts' Motocross Academy, MX Academy, Plotts Perfect. Training. So we got Justin Starling finally jumped on, John Touchton. We got a lot of people. There was another comment. Oh, Josh Rosa said that moto should have been 5 laps. We could have did that, Josh, but we wouldn't have gotten out in there until about 10 o'clock at night.
Yeah, I thought it was actually good time-wise, but because I was thinking that. I'm like, I could have went a little longer, but, you know, it depends on, you know how it is. One guy wants to leave at 5, next guy doesn't care if he leaves at 8:30. So, you know.
I like the one-lap motos, you know, myself.
Right.
Start and go to the checkers and you're good to go. Logan pulled out a Tomac in Moto 1.
Right on, Logan.
Yes, he did.
I was pulling for you, buddy, man.
He was
the
ripping.
The towel was flying.
I had to ask him, too, because we're talking about Logan Mortberg, number 317 there.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't see he was on the inside gate, and I think this is the one you're talking about, John. I didn't see his start.
No, he hit the gate.
He hit the gate.
Or he rolled into it.
Yeah. But I didn't see the whole thing. I just know when he came in the first corner, he was like 5 bike lengths back, and I pulled him off. I said, or we came up to the podium. I said, what happened on the gate? And I couldn't see. I just knew that's not what Logan does.
Mm-hmm.
And he told me he hit the gate, and he did. He rode balls to the walls all the way out. We got Brad Newman jumping on, man. All you guys jumping on, I'm loving it. Here, as we're wrapping up the show, the Cannon crew jumping on right there. Garrett Cannon, the 823, threw down some solid motos all weekend long, battled out with Dave Freeze. Man, it was
awesome.
a great time. Larry's Giant Subs was in the house. We had Bobby Williams from Pro Action in the house, Jason Beck from Bex Tech, Donnie from DSI. We had, dude, a guy that we got to give a mention to,
all right.
The number 58, Keith Ulrich,
mm-hmm.
was a stud. You probably didn't get to see as many motos as I did. Michael Kerr says, big deal. No, I'm just kidding. You probably didn't get to see all the motos that I did, but he, four motos for sure, because I carried his plaques back for him, four number ones.
Awesome.
Plus 30, plus 40, plus 50, plus 55 class.
What number?
58.
Oh, yeah. I saw a few of the races, yep. One of the races, that dude, because I don't know him, but he was like last in the first turn.
Yeah.
And I think he just walked by everybody.
Yeah. I told his wife, I said, you know, we called me and Dean Dias the third, Die 55. We were up there talking, and I was like, we got to come up with a name for him. Dean does a lot of announcing as well.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, dude, he's like a stud. I'm like, yeah, he's a stellar stud. So I told his wife, I said, hey, we came up with a name for your husband. She's like, what? I'm like, we're calling him the Stellar Stud. She's like,
Stellar Stud.
He's a savage, not a stud. And I'm like,
that's right.
Yeah, he's a savage.
Yeah.
Cole Harley, another shout out, the 100. Great ride off of six hole shots, 6 wins.
Yeah.
Cole, a good friend, a Motostop supported rider. And we, you know, went through a little funk the last few races, and I had to call him out and put him in his place. So we named him Caroline.
Mm-hmm.
And I told him for now on, we would only refer to him as Caroline until he started riding like a boy again. And he came up to me on the podium. So we got Hunter Blackledge, Owen Pixon over there on Instagram. We see you, Owen Pixon, riding for Team Taco Shack out there. This is our local spotlight, local shout-out as we go through. Looks like we're getting a lot of action, so I don't really want to wrap it up. Not plus 30, I got that one.
I wanted to say something about Cole. I don't know Cole. I've never met him, but spoke to his dad a little bit.
Yeah.
Mark. And my hat's off to his starts. Because he was on. I mean, you know, starting in that sand at Bostwick is definitely a little tricky. It's not like some traditional starts where there's a little clay or anything hard-packed. And he had it nailed.
Yeah.
I mean, there was a couple starts that looked like he was like 4 bikes in the first turn ahead. Like, I was just like, wow.
Well, he normally has always great starts. But if you watch his riding style and his thing last 2 races, literally you would have probably said he's a mediocre C rider. And then to come up this weekend, and the poise he had, the mentality, you know, he got out and he was actually running in front of the 450A because we put the A and B guys together for a while.
Mm-hmm.
So he's actually running in front of the 450A class. And I think in the past, Cole Harley would have, you know, not backed it off, made mistakes. Maybe, you know, he's not one prone to get wrecked often, but he's not also one to just back it off. He ran the pace he could for about 2 laps, and he got down to his next pace. And he was able to lead the 450B in the 450B in the 250B class and walk home with those. I mean, great ride.
Oh, a very fluent rider.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can see it.
Style for days. Yep. So I got to give a shout out to HBD Moto Graphics, always a supporter of, you know, mine and the Florida Georgia Championship. We had Moto FX t-shirts out there this weekend. Who else am I missing? Oh, we had Liquid Molly from the Florida Motocross out there. They're a, like, I thought liquid we had some up there, like a oil company. They have like additives, fuel additives and stuff. Big Deal Productions always. Who else are we missing? Oh, Moto Faith Ministries. Nate Ingram. How do we miss Moto Faith Ministries?
Moto Faith was out there,
The whole Ingram family putting down for us.
Did a nice service Sunday morning.
Absolutely. You got to attend that?
Yeah. You were calling me to the gate or to the sign-up tower.
I was.
During it, I heard the thing going off, so I was like, I got to go.
I was.
Yeah, yeah.
Yep, my mom got to jump in there. My mom normally likes to go to church, and we brought her out to a race, so she got to join it.
Your mom? Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's right.
Yeah, my mom.
And your mom, she got had a flat tire.
She did. She did on the way down. She poor mom drove down for probably about 10 hours, and as she pulls in the gate, she gets a flat tire. The front number plate on Nate Ingram's bike, John, how about that? Kim Ingram put it together for him. If you guys don't know, the pastor, Nate Ingram, is a police officer by day. So she made him a number plate on the front. And the 5 is made out of bacon strips. And the O is made out of a donut.
Wow, I didn't realize that.
So 5-0 for the pig. Then you got bacon and then donuts. Is that not classic right there?
That's awesome. I didn't know that. I thought it was crayon for a second.
No, she had it made for him. And that is epic. So, dude, well, it's been an amazing show. Episode 22 here at the Motostop Show. It's been fun. We hope you guys enjoyed it. Aiden Rourke, we see you right there. Rourke, I hope I'm saying that right, man. I hope I didn't mess it up. stay tuned. Make sure you check it out. Like I said, Poy Dog Show coming up Wednesday at 8 o'clock. Make sure you check out NDA Action Sports. I'll be sharing the links. Make sure you check out Big Deal Productions, their photos. The photo gallery from past, current, and the future races coming up. They're so good, they take pictures of you before you even get out on the track. So make sure you check them out. Not only pictures, they also do videos. If you want to make memories of a lifetime that you can put on all your social medias, everything, they are the biggest deal in the production company.
I just saw all that just today.
Yes.
And I say, I thought, my hat's off. It rocked.
Dude, amazing studio. Yeah. They allow us. They open the studio up to us. I gave you guys a quick insight before. We are going to update it. Justin said he's going to get us some new stuff, so we're going to hold that to you. We're going to get Damien. We're going to get some other guys to put some stuff in the studio. If you got ideas what we should put in the studio, you know what? Maybe we do like a highlighted name back here. Each week we pick a different person that's in our chat and put them up there. You know, something to get them involved. We'll see. Any ideas you guys got, let us know. We want to continue to grow. Make sure you check us out. We're on iTunes, Stitcher, TuneIn Radio. TheMotostopShow.com is where you can find all of our YouTube pages, the latest and greatest. You can definitely check out everything that Big Deal Productions do. Whether you don't even like moto, they have all kind of stuff. They have the production life videos, which is a real cool series that they film. The backside of what's going on with all the filming and stuff they do. So a lot of great entertainment for you guys going out there. May 7th, we're headed down to Dade City Raceway. Mm-hmm. You can always check this guy out, PlottsMX, at PlottsMX. .com or
PlotsMX.com, PlotsMX, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, you know, the whole deal.
Just scream. Tag me. We'll get you hooked up.
Yeah.
Damien Plotts, we can't leave yet. We got to talk.
A little bit about,
a Plotts tech tip or training tip for the week.
Tech tip, training tip for the week. Well, I'm going to tell you. A couple weeks ago, you came to me and said, hey, man, I like to do this. And I thought it was a cool idea.
Yeah.
So the first week, I made a video. Second week, I basically just sent you a text with everything, and it was good.
No, it's good.
Still trying to figure it out a little bit, you know, because I want it to be valuable, but I don't want it to be so long.
Let me tell you from my point of view, I love both ways. So I think the vibe and the mixture is what I was coming at. And so
I realized, though, I can never be a movie star because I cannot read lines.
Yeah, it's okay.
I had to read like every line like 3 times. My wife laughed at me the whole time I made that video. I swear to God, I did. And I was like, well, I thought I'd go right through this. And I kept going, edit that. Funny. But anyways, my tech tip this week from Plotts MX is I developed something called a fast chart, which it's going to be a little blurry, which is fine. No, it's fine.
Oh, you don't want to. Yeah, I see what you did there.
Yeah.
Oh, it was a sneak peek. That was a teaser. He said, here's the lollipop. You can't taste it. Give it back. Here, no. You almost won your first race, but then you got to come to the plot.
Yep, it was, PC was calling you.
Yeah.
But you were in the toilet.
Mitch Payton was rolling up to your front door.
Anyways, I developed the fast chart many years ago, and but I didn't call it the fast chart. And I was like, you know what? I have a name for this. So students that come to me, I give it to them. I say, look, if you want to go to the next level in your riding, whatever it may be, this is a great approach to it. Because I believe a few things when it comes to training. One, what's the safest, quickest, fast way to become a better rider? Safety is a big thing. A lot of guys don't do that. And I'll tell you why I say that. I have so many parents that came to me over the years and says, please teach my kid how to do that 80-foot triple over there. Okay, good. Can I see him do a lap? There's a turn before it that has three ruts in it. The kid can't even ride through the ruts. He can't. Everything is totally wrong. And I said, how about we switch it around? I'll teach your son or daughter how to go through this section with so much momentum, confidence. It's going to be harder for him to not jump that triple than to jump it. You know?
Yep.
Well, some of them look at me like I flip something upside down in their brain and they're like, oh, wait a minute. All the other kids are jumping it. Okay. You don't need to do it right now, possibly.
Right.
Unless you want to raise that risk level up, like I kept talking about with the Tomac and the starts. So anyways, in my fast chart here, which, you know, it's a little blurry. It's all right. Do that.
We got Photoshop. We could blur it out for
right
you.
Right on. I believe that positioning is everything. When you watch a national, you watch Supercross, best guys in the world, you'll notice something. There's always a trend. If they mess up, it may take them a split second to get back into their perfect position. Doesn't matter if they're in the whoops, in a rhythm section, in a rut, on a straightaway, whatever it is, even coming out of the gate. Their neutral, good body position is always there. You go to a local race like we're at Bostwick, and you see guys out there that aren't at the pro level, and you'll see that, let's say there's nine turns and there's nine jumps on a track and, you know, several rough straightaways. A lot of guys will have perfect body position one or two times on the whole race. And every time they get out of it, they don't fix it other than maybe one or two times. So I believe that's a big difference. It's not just about, oh, I can go down this straightaway fast. I believe anyone can go down the start straightaway just as fast as Dungy does or Tomac.
Right.
And I believe that you could probably go to Salt Lake City and maybe jump those rhythm sections one or two times.
You've seen me ride before, haven't you? I'm pretty damn good.
That's right. But what I'm getting at is...
I could definitely jump them one time.
One time, right. So what I'm getting at is if a rider's out there and says, look, how do I get to the next level? This fast chart I developed, it starts out like a pyramid. It starts out with position, and then it goes into an A, a B, and a C. And it's basically accelerating, braking, and cornering. You could go out with your mom, dad, brother, sister, aunt, uncle, whatever, or even come to a trainer like me. I'd love to see you all come to Plotts MX training. But I know not everyone's going to do that. I encourage you to come out and at least try it out and see what we got to offer. But if you do that, you're going to find that I'm going to focus on this fast chart. So when you finally end up leaving, at least these three or four things, you're going to feel like a much different rider.
Mm-hmm.
You know? Now, at that point, this chart right here is developed basically for your beginner riders up to your... national rider that's not quite making a top 10 in a Supercross or a top 10 in a national.
Okay.
At that point, then you got to start focusing on a lot more stuff. You know what I mean? But at least if you focus on these few simple things, it's a safe way to become such much of a better rider.
Yeah. I agree, and I like it. And, you know, one thing that I picked up on is body position. And most people will hear that and they're going to think, okay, you know, stand up in attack position or whatever, but there's so much more to body position than just,
there is a lot more.
You know, attack position from your feet all the way up to your head, whether you're sitting down, you're accelerating, you're braking, you know, you're going through a rough section with squeezing the bike with your knees. I mean, every section requires something different. There's not one unique position to put you there. And I think just kind of looking at that is probably what that, you know, dives into and plus more. So
it does. I mean, you know, there's some several consistencies you'll see, you know, when you look at the accelerating, the braking, or the cornering. First thing I got there is focusing on the balls of your feet, you know, and you could go even to a local race like a Boston, we can see the guy that's winning the A class.
Oh, yeah.
is that guy going to go and compete at Southwick National in a few weeks? I mean, it's not in a few weeks, but if it were, I'm saying. Maybe not.
I wish it was.
Right. But what I'm getting at is it's the few simple little things that make you successful, you know? Actually, I used to have that written all over the place. I had like little notes, you know? A lot of us do that. Few simple disciplines practice every day.
Yeah.
Equals success. Hey, it's kind of simple.
You see what Andrew from FMG right there, Florida Motocross Group, posted? I think he stole that from Lawnmower. Right now, because it says not how fast you do it, it's how fast you do it well.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lawnmower ad going on. I believe it's John Deere. It says it's not how fast you cut your grass, it's how well you cut your grass fast.
I think I did see that one.
So, Andrew, I love it, dude. And then Adam Rourke right there said not how fast you go, it's how well you go fast. That's what I'm talking about. Andrew, hashtag John Deere.
John Deere. There you go. We got the commercial man on board. I love it.
I love it.
Yeah. And you know, right there, what you're saying, there's actually a good point to some of that.
There's a lot,
Here's what I mean, is a guy like Tomax and the guys that are making it to that level, they're doing these simple things we're talking about. They're just consistently doing it.
Right.
Where the guy that's a local A rider or the next up and coming B rider, he can do it. A CJ Harris can do it. One lap.
I don't even do one lap.
I was trying to give you credit.
I know. I appreciate it.
I mean, it's funny. I'm retired pro racing. I'm 43 years old. You brought up Dana Krause. He came to Boswick, raced the A Moto. You know, he's in his 20s. Good local A rider. Tried to do some Canadian Nationals for a while. I actually helped train Dana. He's from Pennsylvania.
Okay.
Way back when he was probably like 13 years old.
Really?
I haven't barely seen the dude since then because he moved to Florida. Ironically, I come to Florida, so hey, Dana, what's up? But he laughed because he came up and rode with me at Boswick, and he made a comment. He's like, wow, he goes, I rode with you that day and followed you around Plotts, and he's like, it's weird. Any given section, it looks like you went like this and just went, phew, took off. And I said to him, I don't train anymore. I don't have a bike set up. I don't have any of that, but I can do a lot of it. For one lap.
Well, folks, we've had you guys on here a long time tonight. It's been fun. As when I get Damien in, it's definitely a good bench racing session, and I love having
him
here. So we appreciate all you guys. I know it's been a long night. Make sure you check out all the archives on the Motostop Show. Click like, click subscribe. Make sure you give us your comments. Share it. Tell all your friends, family. It doesn't matter. We'll see you guys May 7th, Dade City. Big Deal Productions, Brian, Tom, thank you guys. Thanks to all of our sponsors. Plotts family, we thank you guys for hanging out with us all night. Tristan, Gavin, where are you guys at? Come here.
Hurry up.
Come say hi. As they come into the studio.
We're heading out.
They're probably sleeping.
Yeah, I brought them here. First time racers.
Come over here.
BMX champions.
There you go.
Say what's up, everybody. Look in the camera. Right there.
All right, guys. It's been fun. It's been real. Make sure you guys check us out next week, themotostopshow.com. From Damien Plotts, myself, CJ Harris, the host that brings you the most. We're out. Peace.
Good job, guys.
Good job, bro. Yeah.